This is Sunday Morning Together across Australia on Vision Christian Radio.
And good morning to you. This is Sunday Morning Together. It's wonderful to be back in the chair this week. Big thank you to Robbo for filling in last week. I had the pleasure of listening last week, so I got to sit on your side of the fence and as a listener last week, which was fantastic. Well, my guest and co-host today is a man who's no stranger to these studios. He's been in many times. Stu Millar, who's, how do I describe you, Stu? A tragic, a passionate man about evangelism, about the Lord.
Yep.
What's the best way to describe Stu Millar?
Oh, well, that's a really deep question to start off with, isn't it?
Well, let me cut to the chase here. So you're the founder and director of Train to Proclaim.
Yes.
Almost said strain then, strain to proclaim. I guess it's almost the same thing, isn't it?
We've got a strain as well.
We've got to do that. So about 20 years ago that came into being.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
What were the circumstances around that at the time that actually led you to start something?
Yeah, well, the Lord really clearly led us across to Australia. We're from New Zealand originally, and I was doing evangelism training in New Zealand. And when we came over here, I felt a very strong call, and we set up a ministry and just started from here.
Okay. And so this is about helping people to be able to share their faith.
That's right.
Something that a lot of Christians really want to do, but are really scared about it.
Absolutely. I find that most Christians want to be able to communicate the gospel. We know we're meant to. Mm-hmm. We've heard 1,000 sermons, go into all the world and preach the gospel. Mm. And then that's
a great idea.
It's a great idea.
For somebody else.
For someone else. Yeah. But a lot of people are going, well, I want to, but I really don't know how. How do you do it? How do you start the conversation? When you do have a conversation, often people aren't prepared and they get all tongue-tied. And then afterwards they think about the conversation and they reminisce and they go, why did I say that? Or why didn't I say this? And we're really not prepared for that moment. And unfortunately, many Christians don't actually understand even what the gospel is. If you got 20 Christians together and you said, tell me what the gospel is, you may get 20 different answers. And you're sort of going, well, if this is the gospel that we're supposed to be taking out into all the world that Jesus has commanded us to do, we need to know what it is and how to simply communicate it in a language that non-Christians can understand.
Well, let's answer that question. What, according to Stu Millar, what is the gospel?
Okay, so the gospel, I would say there's two streams of thought within the Christian church. Is that the gospel of the kingdom and the gospel of salvation.
Mm-hmm.
And the gospel of the kingdom is a much larger picture of the gospel. Like the four gospels that you read, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, you know, cover a lot more than just salvation.
Yeah.
There's a lot of how to live your life in the kingdom of God, and the kingdom is near. And that, of course, is very valid as well.
Mm.
But when Jesus said to go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creatures, he wasn't meaning that you've got to go through all the teaching and the entire, you know, four gospels that we read or cover everything about that. It's there's a message of salvation about coming into the kingdom of God, which is the message of salvation. Now, I like to ask three questions. It's like, why do we need to be saved? How can Jesus save us, and what do we need to do in order to be saved? And that really sums up the essence of the gospel.
Mm.
Why do we need to be saved? Because we are sinners. We have broken God's laws. We rightly should be judged by him on judgment day, but he loves us. He doesn't want us to be judged. He doesn't want to punish us for the things that we've done wrong. He wants us to be in heaven, but heaven's a perfect place, and there's no way that we in our current state can ever make it into heaven because we're enemies of God. We've broken his laws. We've gone our own way, and we need to put that right. We need to put the relationship right before we can come into that place with God. And so that leads us to the second part, which is, how can Jesus save us? I was just testing you there, Phil.
So how can Jesus save us?
Yeah, how can Jesus save us? Well, of course, he came to earth. He died on the cross. He paid the punishment for everything that I've done wrong, you've done wrong, everyone in this world has done wrong. He's made a way possible for us to be forgiven, cleansed, and have a fresh start, a new start, completely forgiven, a new person, and we can make it into heaven, a perfect place with a perfect record. But we've got to do something, which leads us on to the third part, which is, what do we need to do to be saved?
Mm. So what do we need to do?
What do we need to do, Stu? What do we need to do? We need to make a commitment to turn away from the wrong things in our lives. The Bible calls that repentance, turning away from the walking our way and doing things our way and turning around and living life God's way. And we need to surrender our lives over to Jesus Christ, make him the number one priority of our lives. We call that lordship, making him Lord of our lives. But for non-Christians, I talk about turning away from wrong things and surrendering our lives over to Jesus. So that's the essence of the gospel. It covers sin, righteousness, judgment, Jesus as Savior, Jesus as Lord. That would be five key ingredients of the gospel that are covered through those three questions.
And that's really the gospel of salvation, but it then opens the door to the gospel of the kingdom.
Of the kingdom, yeah, absolutely. And that's the discipleship process, isn't it? Yeah, the sanctification, you know, growing in our knowledge of Christ.
Well, that great commission, you know, Matthew 28, go into all the world. And you know, my summary, preach the gospel, make disciples. They're the two key things that we need to be doing.
Absolutely.
Wonderful. And I wonder if we might actually be able to do a little bit of role playing.
Sure.
I don't know if you do this in your training sessions, do you?
A little bit.
A little bit. Yeah. Okay. So let's do some of that. Let's set the scene here.
Sure.
Maybe we're on a plane together.
Okay.
And captive audience.
We've got the plane.
The next hour and a half or so together. And maybe I'm one of those passengers that sits down and puts my earphones in, or I'm just not looking like I'm really wanting to talk to you, but you're keen to share the gospel with me. What do you do?
Yeah. If someone's actually doesn't have Bluetooth and actually has a physical headphones, I normally have my iPad with me. And I say, hey, I noticed you've got some headphones there. I've actually got a 7-minute video that I show to people and get their responses for it. Would you like to have a look at it? And the 7-minute videos in the app that we produce called G7, you can use either a video version or an interactive version.
Okay.
Now, if someone doesn't put their headphones in, they don't normally do it straight away. It's normally hello, how you going? Where are you going? And then that's when I wait for that little pregnant pause where there's, you know, you finish talking and that's when I jump. That's the moment that you say, hey, I'd love you to have a look at an app that we've produced. And it's, oh, okay, well, what is it? It's something we're doing with Christian churches. So it's nothing weird or freaky or anything. You can relax. And then away I go. I just use the app and take them through the gospel. I mainly use the interactive version. But if someone's really quick and they're putting headphones on and, you know, I'd say, hey, mate, I've got a before you start listening to your music, do you want to jack into my iPad? I've got a video here that I'd really be keen to see what you think of it. I remember I did that on the way back from Melbourne to Brisbane one time. Like I say, most of the time I'm using the interactive. I love the interactive version of the app. But I did use the video this time. It was an Irish guy. And he watched it through, and then we talked for an hour and a half, at least, on the way home. It was we talked about all sorts of things, what was going on in Ireland with Protestants and Catholics and all this thing, and he was telling me it's pretty much not a religious thing, it's more a political thing, and we were looking at that. But we had a really good conversation, because he had a lot of questions that were barriers to coming to faith, you know, and then, you know, where he'd come from and how he'd been brought up. And so we were able to knock off the whole religion thing and talk about a relationship with God, relationship with your Creator, not just about following some do's and don'ts or belonging to this tribe or this tribe. It's about having that personal connection with God. So we had a fantastic time. But the video was the thing that was the catalyst, because that opened him up, and that was the gospel.
Mm.
And that confronted him with his eternity. So, yeah, it was good. Yeah.
Having an app is great, and I know you're very keen to spread the word about the app that you've created. So, Gospel in 7.
Yeah, G7.
G7. So you just go put that in your app store, you'll find
that's
it.
That's right, yeah.
And I'm guessing it's pretty, or in fact, I know it's pretty intuitive to use.
It is, yeah.
But what if you don't have something like that? So what's a good way to start the conversation?
Well, I think, naturally conversations start if you're in a situation where you're chatting. If someone puts their headphones in, it's very hard without being deliberate and intentional to do something. And that's why the app's quite good, you know, to have something. Hey, do you want to jack into this? Do you want to have a look at this?
Yeah.
You need something intentional. You may use a tract. Some people like using tracks. They've got them in their pocket. They can pull it out and they might say, hey, can I show you something? But you've got to be intentional about that start, because often the conversation doesn't naturally lead to talking about Jesus, and most of us know that. That's why a lot of Christians go, well, how do you start? You know, how do you get into this? You know, and I think there's something to be said for being intentional about being direct about it, and that is this. I've tried all sorts of different evangelism without tools, without tracks, without, you know, and tried many tracks and tools over the years. The G7's fantastic. I've landed on that. But when I used to use no tracks, you sort of just wander up to someone, hey, g'day, mate, how you going? And they, oh, yeah, good, good. And they're sort of looking at you and they've got their arms crossed and they're like, what do you want, mate? Are you trying to sell me something? You know, they're suspicious of you. And so you try and put them at ease. And, oh, did you see the rugby on the weekend? And, oh, yeah, what team do you support? You know, and you get chat. And then they relax. They go, oh, maybe he's just a friendly guy.
Yeah.
And then the body language changes and then they go down. But eventually you've got to stop talking about rugby. You want to talk to them about Jesus. And so I used to use little lines like, hey, by the way, are you a spiritual person at all? Or, hey, do you go to church? Are you a church person? You know, try to use a spiritual question to transition from the physical to the spiritual. But what I found is that at that point, as soon as I say that, the arms go crossed again, and then people are like, that's why you came over to me. You want to preach to me. It's like it's disingenuous. Like I've fooled them. And so I found it really difficult. I find it much easier now with evangelism. When I go up to someone, I say who I am, who I'm working with, what I'm doing, and how long it's going to take. You know, so the introduction with the G7 covers all of that. So it's right up front. Now, if someone wants to say no, you say, hey, no worries, mate. You have a great day. But 9 out of 10 people will do it with you, which is pretty good strike rate if you choose the right people and they've got some time. It's about, I think, being intentional and upfront. There's a lot to be said for it.
You raise a really interesting point, I think, and the motivation is at the heart here, because if people, smell that this isn't quite right, doesn't pass the sniff test, they're going to shut down.
They will.
And what you've just said is, I'm going to be straight up with you right from the start here.
Yep.
And if you're not interested in having this conversation, that's okay.
Yeah, absolutely.
But 9 out of 10 are.
Yeah.
If you approach it the right way. It's really good. We're going to talk some more about this. Thank you,
sure.
Stu. Stu Millar is my guest. He's the founder and director of Train to Proclaim. And very shortly, you get to lead us in communion.
Cool.
Stu, which is an honor for us to be able to do that together. Mm. What's a good way for us to prepare ourselves for that this morning?
Well, we can pray. We can settle our hearts and start thinking about what communion's all about.
This is Sunday Morning Together across Australia on Vision Christian Radio.
I want to start with sharing my favourite scripture, which is Romans chapter 5, verse 8. And God demonstrates his love towards us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. One of the reasons I love the scripture so much is it shows God didn't just say, I love you. He demonstrates his love for us. Jesus died in our place. He left heaven. He came to earth. He willingly accepted the punishment for the things that we've done wrong. Even though we were actively living for ourselves and ignoring the one who gave us life, every breath that we have is a gift from God. And yet we chose to ignore him. We chose to break his laws and to live life our own way. But did he write us off? No. Jesus did the opposite. He demonstrated his love towards us by dying a cruel, painful death on a cross. And then he rose from the dead, showing his power and his victory over death. Now, we know that there's a day of reckoning coming for each of us. Each of us will stand before God's judgment seat and have to give an account of our lives. And God rightly should give a just punishment for the wrongs that we've done. But he doesn't want to. If we're prepared to accept the gift offered to us, the loving sacrifice that Jesus made in our place, if we're willing to turn from the wrong and surrender our lives to Jesus Christ, he offers us forgiveness, a clean slate, a fresh start, relationship with him, and eternity in heaven. Wow. That is an incredible thing. And that's worth pausing and reflecting on as we look at communion today. Jesus wants to meet us now as a friend, not later as a judge. And I don't know what more he can do to show his love for us than he's already done. He's given up everything by coming and dying for us. We know in James it tells us that faith without works is dead. And in other words, the evidence of our faith should be reflected in the way that we live our lives. And we can't just say we have faith and then live however we like. We must demonstrate it in our actions. But does that mean we have to be perfect? Of course not. None of us are. But despite our imperfections, our faith should shine through loud and proud. Just like in Romans 5:8, God just doesn't say, hey, you guys, I love you. He demonstrates his love. And so we should demonstrate our faith by living it out as well. That's the challenge anyway. So as we reflect on communion today, as we reflect on the body of Christ, and you can take the bread right now if you like and eat it together. And let's take it and eat it. And just think about the body that was broken for us, Christ's body, the sacrifice he made. And let's take the cup and think about the blood that was shed for the forgiveness of our sins, the cleansing, to give us that clean slate as we surrender our lives to Christ. Let's take that and drink that now. Father, we thank you today for sending your son Jesus to die for us. We thank you that even though we were going our own way, breaking your laws, living life and ignoring the one who gave us life and breath, you didn't wipe us out. You didn't write us off. You loved us and you demonstrated that love by sending Jesus to come and die on the cross for us. We're so thankful, God, for what you've done. We're thankful for the sacrifice and that, Lord, we serve a risen Lord, one that isn't in the grave but is alive forevermore, that has the victory over death, the victory over hell, and that we have that victory as we surrender to you and come into that place of knowing you. And so we thank you today, Lord, and we pray for your blessing on everyone listening to the service this morning. We pray, Lord, you would impact our lives and help us to know afresh and anew the impact of what Christ has done for us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Sunday morning together across Australia on Vision Christian Radio.
Thank you so much, Stu, for leading us through communion. That was wonderful. Well, we get to change gears a little bit right now. Mm-hmm. Stu Millar is my guest here this morning, by the way, if you've just tuned in. Stu is the director, founder of Train to Proclaim, which is all about helping people to be able to share their faith well. And we'll get to more of that in a few moments. But let's get to choosing some music here right now.
Sure.
And you've been a guest here on Sunday Morning Together mm-hmm. before, last time when you came in.
Yes.
And we asked you, and you initially said a song that I had never heard of.
That's right.
But the one you've chosen today is one of my favourites.
It's a fantastic song.
Why this song?
All right. Well, the song is The Goodness of God. And some viewers may be aware that my son passed away, my 15-year-old boy, just recently, about a month ago.
Mm.
8 months ago, he was diagnosed with a diffused high-grade brain glioma, so a brain cancer, inoperable and incurable. We obviously prayed for a miracle. We asked the Lord for a miracle, and we had a lot of people praying for him around the world. But we trust God, and we know that regardless of what happens, that God is good. And we had this mentality right from the beginning about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego when they came before the king, and the king said, you need to bow down. And they said, no. And they said, I'm going to throw you in the furnace, and you're going to die. And they said, our God will surely deliver us. But even if he does not, we will still not bow down. And so we prayed, we believed for a healing, but we thought, even if it does not happen in this life, we know that in eternity it will happen. One way or another, Matthew will be healed, and we will trust the Lord regardless, and we know that God's good regardless. And a lot of people will start to doubt the goodness of God when bad things happen in their lives, but we were going, you know what? Our circumstances doesn't change the character of God. God is good all the time, and it doesn't matter what's happening in your life. Things change in your life, but God remains the same. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's good. And we know his goodness, and we've seen his presence and his love walking with us through this whole journey the last 9 months now. And so even though it's been painful at times, we've known his presence and we've known the blessing of God and his goodness.
This is really rubber meets the road stuff, Stu. And thank you for sharing this, because this I can imagine, and I can only imagine what it's been like for you, because I haven't been through that myself.
Sure.
as a parent.
Mm.
But the goodness of God, to keep focused on that, is so different to most people focusing on the problem.
Mm.
And it's liberating,
yep.
I can imagine.
Absolutely. I mean, pretty much from the day of diagnosis, I've sung this almost every day. I've had my guitar out when I had my time with the Lord. And, I mean, initially I couldn't really sing, to be honest. I was just picking it out on my guitar, you know, because sometimes I was crying. It was a very emotional time, but I just wanted to declare every day, God, you're good. Regardless of what's going on, you're good. We know that. And so, yeah.
Wow.
It's a great declaration.
Well, we're going to play C.C. Winans' version of it. You're off the hook. You don't have to get your guitar out. But just let these words soak over you, man, especially if you're going through something right now. Maybe you've had some bad news. Remember the goodness of God. This is by request this morning for my guest co-host, Stu Millar, C.C. Winans, and the goodness of God. Sunday morning together on Vision.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me all my days.
Unfortunately, due to copyright, we can't include this song in the podcast, but I do encourage you to look it up. C.C. Winans, Goodness of God.
Sunday morning together, across Australia, on Vision Christian Radio.
Let's start at the beginning of your story, Stu. You were born at a very young age. Do you remember the year?
Yes, 1973.
1973. What does that make you now?
51. 51. Just had my birthday.
Oh, happy birthday.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So what sort of family circumstance were you born into?
Well, I was born into a non-Christian family.
Okay.
So, but my parents wanted me to have some sort of a Christian, you know, understanding. And so my mum took me along to a Sunday school.
Okay.
And my brothers. I've got three brothers. And so we all went to Sunday school, and it was boring. I remember that I just like, oh, this is terrible.
Shoot me now.
Yeah. Like, I didn't, you know, I mean, I'm sure that I learned some things and probably the things that are helping me to this day, you know, like, but at the time I remember I can't wait to go to youth group because they play basketball and games and they have fun in youth group and there's girls there, you know, like, so by the time I'd got to that age, I was, you know, very keen to go to youth group and not be involved in this Sunday school. It was at youth group that I got saved. Went to a YFC, Youth for Christ rally, and heard the gospel and had some good youth leaders that clearly communicated the gospel, laid it all out. And I weighed it up because I'm a pretty logical thinker.
Yep.
And I thought, you know, I want to know whether this is real or not. And this is real. It all makes sense. And I had an experience with God, and it changed my life. So
I'm curious. Yeah. You mentioned you weren't in a Christian context, as far as mum and dad were concerned, but they sent you off to church.
Yeah,
and I'm always curious why that is. Why do you think that was?
Mm. Well, I think you know, going back to my parents' generation, there was a strong Christian heritage there, and a lot of people went to church, and a lot of people knew the benefit of a Christian worldview.
Yeah.
And didn't want their kids to go off the, you know, off the rails.
A bit of foundation laying, you think?
Yeah, I think so, yeah. Even though they didn't have a personal relationship with Jesus, to them it was like, you know, the census comes around and you tick, you know, we're Presbyterians. So we tick the Presbyterian box, but are we actively going?
Yeah.
No. But,
So when you then heard the gospel, responded, became a Christian, said it changed your life.
Yes.
What was your parents' reaction to that? Were they like, ooh, this wasn't what we signed up for? Did you all of a sudden become, you know, a bit more radical, passionate?
Absolutely. That's exactly what happened. And they thought, well, I'd gone off the deep end. You know? They thought far out. They said, oh, look, you know, it's great that you're believing in God. That's why we sent you to church. But you're going a bit far with this, Stu, you know, like, you don't need to go all in. Like, you know, it's good that you believe, but you're going a bit far.
Yeah. And your response?
And our response is, there is no too far. Like, if God's real, this changes everything.
Yeah.
Changes the whole thing, you know. And so we tried to share with our parents, and my dad had given his life to the Lord at a Billy Graham rally when he was young.
Right.
And sort of had gone away from the faith. And so there's always been something there with dad. And mum's been a bit more, you know, even though she was the one that took us to church, she was the one that was a bit more unconvinced about the whole thing, and but could see the value of Christian values.
So how did it change your life?
It changed everything. Like, knowing that God was there, knowing that he was real, that you can have a personal relationship with him, and then getting baptized in water and in the Spirit, there was something inside of me that changed. Like, I was a new person, a new creation. Mm. It was no longer the old had gone, the new had come. And so for me, it was like, I just wanted to let everyone know. I thought, this is the best thing ever. You can know the creator of the universe as your friend. And, you know, that will change your life too. And so I started telling people about it at school. My best mate was a Christian, and so we sort of teamed up and supported one another, and we're still best mates to this day. It's been a long time. He's in full-time ministry in New Zealand, doing some incredible things with Hope Project and nationwide evangelism projects over there. So, God changed our lives at a young age, and it was awesome.
You say our. You've said that a few times.
Yeah, yeah.
So is it just your friend, or was it your other siblings?
I've got two brothers that also became Christians. And my older brother is a Presbyterian minister now, and my younger brother is heavily involved in the church and in ministry. Has been working in a secular environment. He's actually just retired. He just sold a company, but he works with us as well. He's on my board. He's great guy. So my oldest brother is still not a Christian. He's been resisting God all his life. And you can see a difference in the lives of my brothers. And, you know, when you see people who have decided to follow Christ and those who haven't. Fortunately, my mother, she's passed away about four years ago. And the week before she died, she gave her life to Christ.
Wow.
She was resistant, but she got cancer. Same as Matthew, different part of the body, but she, as she was going through chemo, she softened, you know, to the gospel, softened to, you know, and praying for her became okay, and then she eventually surrendered. Mm. She gave her life over to the Lord, but she really left it to the last minute, though, Phil, and we don't want that for our dad or for my brother or for anyone.
Well, it's never too late for any of us.
That's
right. And we need to sometimes keep that in perspective too when we're praying for people.
Yeah, absolutely.
How old were you, did you say, when you were saved, Stu?
11.
11.
Mm-hmm.
That's a tender young age.
It's a tender young age, yep.
What happened for you after that? Because, I mean, you mentioned that one of your best mates was a Christian, mm-hmm. and you're sharing your faith with your parents, with your kids, your friends at school, mm-hmm. and so on. How else did that play out for you?
Well, when I first gave my life to the Lord, I was still very, very shy about it. I didn't really want to tell anyone, didn't want to get any mockery. It was pretty rough back in those days with bullying.
I find it hard to believe that you were shy, Stu.
I know. I mean, I'm a pretty extroverted person, but you don't want to put your head out, you know, otherwise someone takes it out, you know, but for no reason.
Whereabouts in New Zealand was this, by the way?
This is in Taranaki, in a place called Hawera.
Yep.
So it's the west coast of the North Island, about halfway down.
Around Mount Plymouth, around that area?
Yeah, yeah, New Plymouth.
Yeah, New Plymouth, New Plymouth.
So, but there is a mountain, Mount Taranaki.
Mount Taranaki, New Plymouth. I'm getting confused.
That's the one? Yeah. Yes. Yeah, beautiful mountain.
The cloud hangs around the top there.
That's right.
Fascinating watch.
It is indeed. It's one of the few places in the world that you can go snowboarding and surfing in the same day.
Wow.
Because it's only 45 minutes up to the slopes and you know, 5 minutes to the beach, but you never want to. If it's snowing up there, then you don't want to go in the sea.
You want a nice thick wetsuit.
That's right. Yeah. But so what was your question?
So through your teen years,
I was a bit of an embarrassed Christian, to be honest, when I first became one. But my best friend Dave also became a Christian, and he was really bold and wanted to tell everyone, and I was like, mate, tone it down, you know, like it was a little bit over the top, but we were mates. And it wasn't until I was 13 when I was baptized in water and in the Holy Spirit. That's when I experienced that boldness come and that real passion to let other people know about Jesus. And that was a real changing point for me. So there was 11 and 13 were two significant moments in my life. And then the rest is history. We just went through it. Shared the gospel at school and left school, did some studies, and then came back and went into full-time ministry, youth ministry originally, and then into training people in churches. So
you weren't baptized in the cold waters at the beach there
No.
The west coast of New Zealand.
No, it was in a sparple.
Chicken. Yeah. That's good. I mean, clearly you're very passionate about the gospel.
Yes.
And the scriptures and you know, God has changed your life. That idea of, it's more than an idea, the reality of a relationship with God, the creator. Yeah. Is there a particular scripture, you know, whether it was preached that first day when you actually made that decision or sometime later in your life that's really you've clung on to?
Yeah, I wouldn't say there was a particular scripture that, I mean, there was a lot. I think it's a combination. I think it actually even went back further than going to youth group, to be honest. I remember when I was in about 10, before youth group days, and I had a Bible and schools teacher. We call them RE or RI here in Australia.
Yep.
And she didn't just talk about the stories in the Bible like the other, you know, religious instruction teachers. She talked about Jesus like she knew him. And she shared, you know, amazing experiences of God working in her life. And it was like, wow, this is not just a dusty old book from 2,000 years ago. This is something really real. And I remember even at that age thinking, I want what she's got. I want a relationship with Jesus. So there wasn't a particular scripture, but I know her testimony really impacted me. And then later on, going to youth group, hearing the gospel, understanding it, and then hearing, you know, at these rallies, these crusades that YFC were running, people sharing their testimonies, and that touched me, and I had an experience, and I felt like the Holy Spirit, you know, was upon me, the physical, you know, presence of God, and it was like, wow, this stuff is really real. I've got to do something about this. I need to surrender my life to Jesus. Yeah.
Wow. It, the power of the story, your own personal story, is so central to sharing faith, isn't it?
Yeah.
As your story unfolded, though, what do you reckon there are some things that really became very apparent to you as these are keys in my life or keys for my relationship with God?
I think it was really key for me that we can't be a silent Christian. We can't be a secret Christian like I was prior to being 13. I think
was your friend Dave a key part of that?
He was, you know, but initially he was annoying. It was like, oh man, do you have to keep talking about God all the time? And like, just keep this on the down low, you know, like, yes, we're both Christians, but, you know. But it wasn't until, like I say, I was baptized in water and the Spirit, and then my life came alive, you know, something changed in me. And and that. But I do remember at school, we had a group in school, a Christian group, and there was Christians there that just wouldn't talk about their faith. They would sort of almost hide in their hope no one saw me coming into the Christian group sort of thing. And people found out that they were in the Christian group and sort of gave them quite a bit of hassle. And they actually had it a lot worse than Dave and I had it because we were just really open and bold about what we were doing. And we got some initial flack. But after a while, there was a lot of respect. People going, you believe what you're saying here, you know. And we ended up having people come up to us and talk to us who we didn't even know. And they're like, oh, you're the religious guys, you know. And, yeah, that's us, you know. And then they'd talk to us. They'd ask us questions about God. And we had all these opportunities. And I think people respect you when you do it. And we started going around the school, you know, and we stuck our finger in the air and go, he lives, we'd yell it out to each other across the thing. And all these non-Christians started to pick it up. It was like this, he lives, and they'd see us. And they didn't even know what they were saying, but we thought this is great, you know. We did speeches on God, you know, when we did our speeches, we'd do them on God and the evidences of God and all these sort of things. And really, but we had a lot of respect from people because we stood up for what we believed. And so if you're saying what's a key, one of those keys, I think don't be a closet Christian. Don't hide away. Don't think that you're going to get more respect or, you know, by being quiet. It's better to be vocal and open and authentic with your faith up front because people will respect you for it.
Yeah, people want to know what you believe.
That's right.
And, you know, to put an Australianism on it, they want you to be fair dinkum.
Yes, absolutely.
And it was as true in, you know, sort of 1980s New Zealand for you as what it is today in Australia.
Absolutely.
Let's paint a bit of a picture of the rest of Stu's world. So you're married.
Kids. Yes, to Maria. I've got four kids. I've got three kids now.
Maria? Well, you still have four kids, Stu.
I still have four kids.
And we'll get to child number four in a few moments. But how did you and Maria meet?
We met at youth group when we were 15.
And that's why you went there.
Well, I wanted to play basketball and meet girls, and I did both.
Yeah, good.
But yeah, we met and we fell in love, and we got engaged when we were 16.
Wow, that's young.
I know, very young. And we got married. Maria was 19, I was 20. She was.
How'd you navigate that? Were your parents okay with that? No,
they weren't.
I can imagine. Yeah. I mean, you're 16, you're full of hormones and everything else. It's like, we're getting married, and mum and dad are going, no, you're not.
Well, there's a whole story behind that, but it's it was an interesting time, and
yeah, okay.
But we both sensed that the Lord had said to us we were going to get married, and yeah. I know that's a bit of a dangerous thing because people go, oh yes, God said I'm going to marry you. Well, I think he needs to speak to both people if that's the case.
He hasn't told me yet.
It's exactly. If God says to you you're going to marry someone, please don't go up and just tell them. Yeah. That may be the end of it. But yeah, he spoke very, very clearly and very strongly to us both. And so we thought, you know what? We might be 16 years old, but we're not trusting in ourselves because we certainly at this age haven't got the ability to make a decision like marriage, you know, a wise decision. We're not old enough. But we trust the God who does know the future, and now we've been married for 30 years. So, I mean, people get married when they're 30, 35 and still end up divorced, you know. I mean, it's not really how old you are, it's is it right?
Mm.
And so we're big believers that, you know, we really should seek the Lord and with every aspect of our life, and marriage is a huge decision.
So I'm trying to do the maths here. You've been married for 30 years. You were 16, born in 1973. So when did you get married?
20.
20, okay. It was a few years later.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Fantastic. So four children came along.
Four children came along, that's right. Yep.
One of them has gone home to be with the Lord.
That's right.
And I can only imagine what that's like as a parent. My wife, Jo, and I have four kids as well, trying to put myself into your shoes. And it's very fresh for you as well.
It is, yeah.
Just recently.
Yep, 3.5 weeks ago.
Yeah.
Yeah, so...
You talked a little bit about this earlier on. We played a song that's been very special for you about the goodness of God.
Yes.
And standing on the solid rock of Christ.
Mm.
When you got that, the news, the diagnosis in the first instance, do you remember what your first thoughts were?
That was 9 months ago now, and I can't really tell you what my first thoughts were. I mean, it was... I think shock, initially you're thinking, far out, this is, you know, because it was laid out, it was not only, we found out it was cancer, but we found out it was inoperable, because it was diffused through the brain, and we found out that it was incurable. So they didn't initially say it was incurable, they said, well, we'll get you onto some radiation, and so we were left up in a little bit in the dark. We thought, flip, this is bad. It's a high-grade cancer. It's diffused through the brain. We can't operate on it. We're going to have radiation, but what does that mean? What is our life? And so in some ways, I think it was actually good that the oncologist didn't just lay it all out in one go, because we needed to process things step by step and then find out that, no, this isn't to cure. It's palliative. It's to give Matthew a bit more time to do the radiation. And so, yeah. But that was a shock. It was a shock for the whole family, but we took the news as a family. We were all there, and we got together and we prayed, and we've spoken about it openly, about, you know, that this doesn't change anything. God's good. We've talked in detail with our kids about it, and yeah, and so all of them are still going on for the Lord. We actually had Matthew and my oldest two got baptized at the end of last year. So wow. I think that sort of prompted a bit more urgency, because they've been talking about it for years. And we always said, when you're ready, we never wanted to force them or you know, push them into getting baptized. We thought when they're ready, they will. And but they've been walking with the Lord for quite a while. But I think the urgency of, you know what, we don't know when our time's up. Why are we not just doing it now? And so three of them on the same day got baptized.
Wow. And that must have been special as a parent.
It was very special.
Yeah.
And it was great to see Matthew standing up and declaring, you know, his faith in Christ. And he only had half you know, the radiation had taken half of his hair out, so he had literally hair on half of his head and not on the other half of his head. And so he was there in the waters, you know, as a cancer patient, saying, you know what, I'm following Jesus.
Mm.
And that was special.
Mm.
Very special.
You mentioned before that many people have said to you, this is not fair.
That's right.
Why is this happening to you? This shouldn't be happening to you.
Yeah.
And you did touch on this earlier about your response to that. But can you just unpack that a little bit more? Because, you know, here you are. You're a man in ministry.
Mm-hmm.
You've been following after, you know, God's call on your life.
Mm.
And it is pretty hard to reconcile those two things. Why do these things happen? Mm. Why do bad things happen to good people?
Mm. Well, I think to start off with, we can't put ourselves in the good people category because all of us are sinners. We're all broken God's laws. And whether you're in ministry or whatever, we are simply sinners saved by grace. And I'm no better than anyone else. And once you start thinking that you're better than anyone else, I think you're in trouble. Mm. And we're all living in the same broken world. And so we had just as much chance of having a son with cancer as you or anyone else. It's a genetic thing that's happened. It's part of the fall. It's part of, you know, what happened in the Garden of Eden when the world broke.
Mm.
And it became a fallen world. And so this happens to people all the time. You hear it happening to people. I mean, it's not until it happens to you that it really impacts you, but you hear it. And it's like, well, why shouldn't it happen to you? When people say, well, it shouldn't be happening to you, Stuart. You're in ministry. It's like, well, why shouldn't it? You know, I'm no different than anyone else. I'm a human being. I'm a sinner. I'm saved by grace. I'm living in this broken world. I have just as much chance of this happening to my family as anyone else. And it's, unfortunately, it's happened to me, but it's just the way it is. But you know what? The end of the day, all of us are dying. And I think we've got to keep that in mind. I mean, and none of us live exactly the same age. You know, what is fair? People say it's not fair. Well, what is fair? Do we all die on our 80th birthday and then that's fair?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's like, well, what, you know, what about someone who lives till 90? Is that unfair that they live to 90 and someone else lived to 80? And recently, I know a friend told me about someone they know of in Melbourne. Their baby died, and but they didn't expect it to live, and it lived for 10 days. And so they were thankful that they had 10 days with their baby. And here we had almost 16 years with Matthew.
Yeah.
You know, every day is a blessing from the Lord. Every breath we have is a blessing from the Lord. It's not a given. It's not a right. Matthew is not my possession. He doesn't belong to me. He belongs to God. And so the Lord gives, the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord, as Job said, you know.
Perspective makes a huge difference.
It makes a massive difference.
But it's still tough, isn't it?
It is, definitely. I'm not under, you know, in any way undermining the pain and the grief that you feel, because obviously we had hopes for Matthew for a long life, and the absence of him at the table, the absence of him at church. You know, every time you, even just before you said, how many children do you have? I say, we've got four children. They're like, oh, we've got three children. It's very,
yeah.
You know, every time something like that happens, there's something inside of you that, yeah. So, but, you know, God is good. And Phil, whether you live for 15 years or 50 years or 100 years, in a million years from now, it's not going to matter. It won't. Mm. Matthew stepped into eternity. He hasn't missed out on one day of life. Not one. He hasn't missed out on anything by dying now rather than dying when he's 80 or 90.
Yeah, that's perspective, isn't it?
Mm.
A big part of your life has been helping other people to share their faith.
Yes.
And I guess leading before that is actually you sharing your faith yourself. You touched a little on that before about the need to just, you know, be yourself, be bold.
Mm-hmm.
What was it that actually led to you to saying, I actually want to help other people to do this?
Yeah, well, we did it ourselves in high school, and I had a passion for sharing the gospel, and then ended up going into youth ministry, as I said to you, and we worked in schools, spoke in assemblies, ran Christian camps, ran youth groups, we did a whole lot of stuff, and we're sharing the gospel, seeing young people come to know the Lord, which is awesome. But we knew there was a big picture, there was a big world out there, and we're like, you know, a couple of guys in a small little town in New Zealand, reaching out to some young people. We're going, we've got this great commission to go into all the world and reach everyone. And we're going, well, what's stopping Christians, because there's a lot of Christians around the world, from reaching out and completing this? Like if one in six in the world, now of course you can argue those statistics because there's a lot of people who would tick the Christian box that aren't actually true believers or followers of Christ, but you know, one in six are saying they're Christian. It would only take us to reach five other people each, and the whole world's reached.
We're done.
We're done. Time to go home, Jesus, you know? So it's like, why are we not doing this? You know, why are we not? And we were both frustrated in our own churches. There was very little proclamation of the gospel. Most Christians didn't even know what the gospel was, let alone how to communicate it. They wouldn't have a clue on how to articulate the gospel to a non-church person without using a whole lot of jargon or the religious language. I call it Christianese that we use at church, you know. Yep. And we're like, really, people are not, they're not ready. They're not trained. They're not prepared. And it was out of that frustration that we had an evangelism training come to our church, and I was just excited about that. And the fact that we were learning a tool that could clearly communicate the gospel without any of the jargon, people were learning how what the gospel is, how to communicate it. I'm thinking, this is what I want to do. And God just spoke to me, and from that point, I got more involved. Became full-time in that organization in New Zealand, started using an early version of the G7. So this is not my invention.
This is your app that you're talking
about.
Yeah,
yeah. So I turned it into an app, but the original presentation, you know, was created by a whole lot of people, and not just in New Zealand. It's got a bit of all sorts of people in it, you know, Billy Graham and lots of people, you know, have really contributed to making a great gospel presentation. Yeah. And so, yeah, I was excited. We're starting to train people, and I saw the excitement in people's faces when we're doing this training. It's like, for some people were in tears. They're like, for the first time in my life, I actually know what to say. I've felt guilty that I haven't been sharing the gospel, but I didn't really know how to start the conversation. I didn't know what to say, you know, and then now I've learned how to do it. And so that's beautiful. But I think probably there's two key things that are stopping the gospel going out. One is people not knowing how. But you know what? I think, Phil, if you really, really want to, you find a way.
Yeah.
You'll find those resources are online. There's video training. You can go out to our website,
trainatoflame.com. Really.
It's at your fingertips. The biggest thing is we need to have the boldness and the heart, the passion to share with others and to have that eternal perspective, which I'm going to be talking about in the best 5-minute sermon you'll hear today.
Yeah, that's it. That's exactly right. Well, I think we could learn a lot actually from a sportswear company, Nike.
Nike, just do it.
Just do it.
Yeah.
And I mean, you talked about that before with your mate at school who you were like, oh, come on, mate, you're getting a bit too out there.
That's right. That's right.
But when you did put it out there and you were just boldly yourself, other people respected you.
Absolutely. Definitely. Yeah.
And I just wondered, do you always do things upside down? Because you came from New Zealand, but yes. And then you went to the world. But, you know, the scriptures say first in Jerusalem, then Judea, and then the ends of the earth.
Well, first in Hara, then Taranaki, then New Zealand, then the end of the earth. Yeah,
then Australia.
Then Australia. Yeah. This is the next step.
So how long have you lived in Oz now?
19 years.
Okay.
Yeah.
So are you a local... Australian?
We're about to get a citizenship.
Oh, really?
Yeah, yeah.
Is that hard?
I haven't filled out the forms yet.
Okay, you can give us an update later on.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. It's become a lot easier lately.
Okay.
Halfway through last year, it changed from being $3,000 to being $495.
Oh, wow.
So we're very thankful for that.
Yeah.
Because it was going to be about $18,000 when we looked at it initially, and we're like, whoa, that's a lot of money.
Yeah.
But now the whole family for, you know, $2,500.
Well, it's wonderful that you're here, that you've been, you know, calling Australia home for the last 19 years.
That's right, yeah.
And helping people here and around the world to share their faith. So the G7 app is probably the simplest thing to remember. If you've got a smartphone or a tablet or something, just go install that app and it'll help you to share the gospel. Is there a website too for Train to Proclaim?
Yeah, traintoproclaim.com.
Okay.
Nice and easy.
Train to proclaim.com, and of course you help people. I mean, you run seminars and all sorts of things as well. So
if you're listening today and going, you know what, it'd be great to have someone come to our church and do some training in evangelism, get in touch with me through the website, and I'd love to, you know, talk with you about it. It's free. We don't charge anything. I mean, obviously, you cover travel costs so we can get there, but basically, our heart, all the resources are free. We just want to get the gospel out into the world and equip people to share the gospel.
Yeah, good stuff.
Thanks for sharing your story. I'll let you prepare for the best 5-minute sermon we'll hear today. Can you give us a little teaser?
All right, it's going to be on my second favorite scripture. You've already heard my first.
Okay.
You're not going to tell us what that is. It's 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 18.
Sunday morning together on Vision Christian Radio.
Well, I have to say at the beginning, Phil, that it is hard for an evangelist to keep to 5 minutes. Sometimes we can be a bit evangelistic, but we're on radio today. We'll be keeping to time. All right. So in the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 4, my second favorite scripture is verse 18, but I'm going to start reading from the verse 16. It says, "So we do not lose heart, though our outer self is wasting away, our inner self is being renewed day by day. For this light momentary affliction is preparing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. As we look not to the things that are seen, but to the things that are unseen. For the things that are seen are transient, but the things that are unseen are eternal." And that last verse in verse 18, where we look to the things that are unseen, not to the things that are seen, because the things that are seen are temporary, they're transient, but the things that are unseen are eternal. Reason I love that is we need to fix our eyes on eternity, and I'm more convinced of that than ever before with what's happened in our life in the last 8 months, because often we spend our lives on things that really don't matter. I want you to ask this question. In 1 million years from today, will it matter what I'm doing right now? You know, that's a challenging question to ask. But, you know, Paul is encouraging us here. He's saying, look, fix your eyes, not on what is seen, but what's unseen, because that's the important thing. Because what is seen is all going to pass away. It's going to be gone. And our lives are like a grain of sand on the beach, a drop of water in the ocean compared to all of eternity. And they go on so quickly. And I don't know about you, Phil, but as you know, I'm 51 now. And as I've gone through life, life's just speeding up faster and faster. And you just realize just how short life is. And for my son, it was 15 years, almost 16. But, you know, that was a short life. We don't know how long our lives are going to last. And even if we live to 90, that's not a lot of time compared to eternity. We can spend our lives on all the things that are temporary, and we can build up riches, or we can do things for ourselves. But what legacy are we going to leave behind? What are we going to invest in that will have eternal value? I want to encourage you that the gospel is of eternal value. The gospel, according to Romans 1:16, says, "I'm not ashamed of the gospel, because it's what? It's the power of God unto salvation for everyone who believes." The gospel is changing millions of lives all around this world. And as the gospel is proclaimed, there's power in the gospel, and the Holy Spirit's touching people's lives, and people are being saved for all of eternity. This matters. It matters to people's eternity that we go and share the gospel. It matters to your workmates, to your schoolmates, to your neighbors, to your friends that don't know Christ, to anyone that you know, your family members that don't know Christ. It matters that you make a stand for them, that you stand up for Jesus, and that you clearly communicate the gospel, because the gospel is so powerful and it can transform others' lives. Are you going to spend your life on the temporary, on the things that are seen? Or are you going to spend your life on the things that are eternal, that are going to make a difference? In verse 16, he says, "So we do not lose heart, though our outer self is wasting away." Paul's saying, look, hey, our self, it's wasting away. Our bodies are decaying. And as you get older, you realize, you know, things are breaking down. They're not working like they used to. But our inner self, he says, is being renewed day by day, because this light momentary affliction, some translations say sufferings, is preparing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. You know what? Our sufferings in this life are nothing compared to the glory that outweighs it all. And we need to keep our eyes focused on eternity. What are you doing with your life that is investing in eternity? Are you sharing the gospel with those around you? If you're not, I'd encourage you to get along to our website, download the G7 app. Just whatever, you don't have to use our tools, whatever works for you, just use something to clearly communicate the gospel to other people. Thank you so much for listening. I hope that you have been encouraged and challenged to have your focus on eternity. Let's pray. Father, thank you for all that you've done in our lives. Thank you, Lord, for saving us, for sending Jesus to die and to pay that punishment for us. Lord, we want to lay our lives down for you. We want to surrender afresh this morning our lives and say, Lord, use us for your glory. Use us for eternal value. Use us in the transformation of other people's lives. May we be your voice. May your Holy Spirit flow through us. I pray for boldness for everyone listening here today who's perhaps freaking out, perhaps saying, I don't think I can do this. We know that we can do all things through you who strengthen us. Greater is you who are in us than he who is in the world. And we pray for strength, for boldness, for clarity, and for an eternal perspective for everyone listening today. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Sunday Morning Together on Vision Christian Radio.
Let's talk a little bit about what's happening this month, Stu. So you are the Australian representative or the go-to person for the global outreach movement in this country, but yes. It is, as the name suggests, global. So just paint a little picture of what GO is actually doing.
Yeah, well, it started about 12 years ago. A couple of German guys were looking at starting an international day for Christians because there was Global Day of the Whale and Global Day of the Toilet, unbelievably.
You serious?
You know? Yeah, it's a day of sanitation. And okay. It's all, you know, you hear of these global days of this and that and whatever. And he said, why do we not have a global day of outreach, which is the reason we're here, the Great Commission reaching out into the world with the gospel. Mm. Christians should have a global day. And so they started it. And
how many years ago was that?
About 12 years ago.
Okay.
And so it just started very small, but it grew rapidly because I think one of the powerful things about it is it's not about a ministry or a particular church or a particular person. It's about all of us collaborating together, no matter what church you go to, no matter what ministry you're involved in, because this is our mission, to go into all the world and preach the gospel and make disciples. It's a great commission. So we're saying, let's be a part of it together. Let's join hands. And the motto of it is, everyone can do something, and together we can reach the world.
And I like that. Yeah. Everyone can do something, and together we can reach the world.
That's right. Because we're not on our own. We're joining hands with brothers and sisters all around the world. And last year, to show you just how much this has grown, there was 34 million Christians involved in Global Outreach Day and month. It's actually a month now, which is the whole month of May. Started off as Global Outreach Day, now it's Global Outreach Month. And we've got a Global Outreach Decade, which is to reach everyone with the gospel by 2033. It was launched last year, like everyone on the face of the planet. And there's a number of different missionary organizations that have committed to that task. And so it's a real effort going on between now and 2033 to reach everyone on the face of the planet. Now, that's a big goal, But, you know, we believe that God can do it. So that's a bit of an overview.
Yeah. And did you say 33 million people?
Yeah, 34 million Christians last year.
And I guess they're the ones that are known because, you know, a big part of this really is just encouraging people to go and share their faith, and they may do that and not actually tell anybody.
That's right.
Other than the person they shared it with.
That's right, yeah. But those who are collaborating together on this, you know, there's 34 million. There was hundreds of millions of people reached with the gospel, and there was 8 million recorded salvations during the month of May last year. So 8 million people. I mean, that's bigger than the size of the whole of New Zealand. You know, that's a huge amount of people. So just wonderful to be a part of this global movement.
It is. When you think of numbers like that, I mean, it's almost the population of Sydney and Melbourne combined.
It is. Yeah.
Just incredible. Mm. One of the key things, though, of the Global Outreach Month that I see is actually not just sharing your faith, but it starts with praying for opportunities.
It does, yes. So prayer is a big part of it, and there's a lot of prayer movements that are linked in with the movement. And you can, if you're a prayer person, you can definitely link in. There's a lot of Zoom calls with hundreds of people on it that you can link in. Canberra Decoration, they are doing a Zoom call every night of throughout the whole month of May.
Okay.
And you can pray with them, and they've got evangelists coming in and encouraging. They've got a daily devotion happening. So there's a lot happening in the prayer thing as well. But one of the key things that we're asking churches, because some people go, well, what do I do? What can I do? If you wanted to promote this in your church, there's a promotional video that you can get off gomovement.world. You can download it. You can play it in your church. It's very inspirational. And then you can encourage people to do two things. One is to pray for five non-Christian people that they know in their life. So think of five people that you know. It might be family members. It might be workmates. It might be your neighbors. And pray for those people and pray for opportunities to be able to reach them. And then be proactive in doing something. It might be inviting your neighbors over for a barbecue. You know how you say, one day we'll invite them over and we'll talk to them about Jesus. Well
now today's the day.
Today's the day. That's right. So, yeah. So it's a very simple strategy, but pray for five people and look for opportunities to reach them. Give them a tract, talk to them about Jesus, whatever you feel comfortable with, you know, go for it. Just do something. Do something to reach them.
Mm. Well, I hope that inspires you, inspires many people to think about that and actually more than think, be part of it. And,
yes.
You know, being involved in things like vision is always a good thing to do. But
yeah.
when you actually, you know, put your own skin on it, so to speak, and start your own conversations and start praying for people yourself, that's a whole new level.
That's right.
And I think it's really the level that God wants us to be at. So the website you mentioned there, gomovement.world.
That's right.
So gomovement.world. And there's a video there you can have a look at.
Yep.
And as far as tools and things go, your app, the G7, the Gospel in 7 app, or your website, train2proclaim.com, all plugs and places to go.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. I wonder if you've got any closing thoughts for us before we part company today. All the things that we've talked about this morning, some of your story about the Global Outreach Month, about the gospel.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, there's been a real encouragement, hopefully, this morning that that we need to understand what the gospel is. We need to proclaim the gospel to those around us. It really makes a difference. We need to believe the gospel. If we believe it, will impact people's lives. It is the power of God unto salvation for everyone who believes. Then let's be a part of something eternal, fixing our eyes not on what is seen, but what is unseen. For that which is seen is temporary, but that which is unseen is eternal. Let's focus on that. So the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ, we're sinners. Why do we need to be saved? We're sinners. We've broken God's laws. One day we'll face a holy judge, a holy God, and be judged for the things that we've done wrong in our lives. And it's not going to be good for us in our current state. But God loves us. He didn't leave us in our current state. He did something about it. There's nothing we could do to work away from the things that we've done wrong. But he sent Jesus to die on the cross and rise from the dead. He was punished in our place. He took our punishment for us. And that's a central part of the gospel, of course, the death and the resurrection of Jesus. But what is our response to that? We need to respond. We need to, in repentance, we need to turn from the things that are wrong in our lives and surrender our lives to Jesus Christ. And if you've never done that before, I'd encourage you to do it. Surrender your life to Jesus. Put your life right with God, and he'll give you a peace. He will give you forgiveness. He'll give you eternal life through him. If you are someone who has had that experience, that you are born again, you've given your life to Christ, I'd encourage you to be resourced and equipped more thoroughly, get trained, and you know, be better at communicating this wonderful message. You know, this is the best message in the world. I think we've got to be the best that we could be at communicating it. So God bless you. Thank you so much for listening today. And we'll finish with a prayer, will we?
That sounds like a wonderful idea.
Okay. Well, Father, we thank you for this time that we've had together. We thank you for everyone listening today who have been a part of the service. We thank you for the encouragement that you've given us. We thank you for the challenge that you've given us. We pray that you, by your Holy Spirit, would move upon our hearts and speak to us, Lord, and help us to be bold, help us to be courageous, help us to be innovative and creative, Help us, Lord, to do everything that we can to make the best impact that we can on those around us for your glory, for your purpose, and for an effect that will be for all of eternity. We pray you would use us for your glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Well, thanks once again, Stu. Really appreciate you coming in, sharing your story. And if you want to connect with what Stu Millar is doing with Train to Proclaim, then just Google. That's probably the simplest way. Yeah. Train to Proclaim.
Yep.
But just get out there.
Yeah.
Share your faith. That's easy to do, and pray. So good on you, mate. Bless you.
Thank you.
Thanks for taking time to listen to this audio on demand from Vision Christian Media. To find out more about us, go to vision.org.au.